Blog Talk Radio.
Good afternoon, New York, and the rest of our listeners around the globe. My name is June Stoyer, and I'm the host of the Organic View Radio Show. Our podcast is available on iTunes, Zune, and every major podcast provider. So if you can't catch the show live, you can download it or simply use our free podcast player on our website, which is www.theorganicview.com. If you have any questions for our guests, there are many ways you can submit your questions. You can post a question on Facebook, send us a tweet on Twitter to @TheOrganicView, or simply give us a call on our caller hotline, which is area code 917-932-1068. Today's topic involves conflicts with wildlife. Do you live in a remote area and are finding that there are new creatures in your backyard, such as coyotes, bears, and skunks? Or perhaps do you live in the suburbs and are constantly chasing squirrels and rabbits out of your garden? Often people will jump and call an exterminator, but then find that other critters will soon become a nuisance. Is there a better way? Can we actually coexist with wildlife and maintain the same lifestyles that we're accustomed to? Due to the rapidly decreasing amount of land for wildlife and the increase of land developments, we are forced to deal with more and more conflicts without any real solutions. Today, my guest is author and naturalist Mr. Joel Thomas. And he's going to be talking about these conflicts with wildlife and better solutions for cohabitation for a more peaceful planet. He will also discuss his new book that he just recently published called Creature Comforts, Wildlife Stories and Solutions, which is actually available on Amazon.com. So if you're dealing with any type of a conflict involving wildlife, this is definitely a show that you don't want to miss. So on that note, I would like to welcome Joel to the show. Joel, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
So tell our audience how you got started. Did you grow up in the outdoors, or did you just were you just a Boy Scout, or what developed your interest in nature?
Yeah, well, sort of all of the above. I was a country kid. I grew up in sort of a rural area in a suburb outside of Buffalo, New York, and sort of spent a lot of time outside flipping over boards for looking for snakes and toads and things like that. And then I went on and became somewhat of an outdoor person the older I got, hiking, hunting, fishing, things like that. Then later on in life, I went back to college and got a degree in veterinary science. Became a New York State licensed veterinary technician, went to work for a large humane society outside of Buffalo, and ultimately began to work with injured wildlife. And along the way, learned that a lot of people had problems and questions and concerns about wildlife. So I've spent the last decade teaching people just exactly what's in their backyard and why it's there and why it's a problem and often why it's not a problem. So I discovered over the years that what people really need is really good information.
Now, what information are they typically getting, and from what agencies? I mean, is this the government agencies that are just not giving out enough information, or is this just, you know, how our society has just evolved where there just isn't enough information out there?
Well, in my experience, government agencies really don't give out any information unless you pry it from them with a crowbar. You know, animal control, you know, local animal control agencies, they're interested in doing as little as possible. There's no standardization in New York State for animal control. If you live in a town with an animal control officer, that means different things to different people. Some animal control officers just handle dogs. Some of them handle wildlife, but only in a very cursory fashion, just by handing the town resident a trap or something, or maybe just coming to get an injured animal, but only in rare instances. So animal control really doesn't help the homeowner that's concerned about a wild animal on their property. Why is that raccoon in the backyard? What's coming to my back porch? You know, those types of things. Why are there squirrels in the attics? I mean, there's a, the list of problems and concerns can be endless.
Oh, yeah, there's without a doubt. I mean, I hear it all the time, and surprisingly enough, from a lot of master gardeners that are kind of, I've spoken to many different people that are just perplexed as to, you know, what's the right thing to do. You know, they don't want to do anything extreme, but, you know, there's obviously got to be a better solution.
Yeah, you know, human nature has us reaching for the telephone, a trap, or headed to the gun rack. And, you know, there may be times when an animal needs to be removed. There may be time when an animal, you know, may have to lose its life in a real serious problem. But, you know, most of the time, human-wildlife conflict has to do with animal behavior and human behavior. So if we can figure out what exactly is going on, we can oftentimes change the behavior of the animal that's on our property. And when we do that, we fix the problem, not only with that animal, but with all animals that maybe come onto our property. If I teach somebody why a raccoon is coming to their property or living on their property, and we fix that problem, we not only fix the problem with that raccoon, we fix the problem with all raccoons. If someone has a problem with rabbits in their garden, if I can teach them how to fix that problem, they'll probably have very few problems with rabbits the next year. And so these solutions tend to work on a broad scale when we talk about animal behavior.
Well, now let's talk about some of the, I guess, the older solutions that people would commonly, resort to, just to show how much we've changed.
Well, typically, again, and this occurs all the time, is, and, you know, I get calls during the course of my job, is that the first thing that people want to do is they want to set a trap, or they want to call someone to set a trap. That doesn't address the root cause of the problem, and these root causes of the problems are almost always environmental. In other words, we have rabbits in the garden because we have a garden and the rabbits can get in the garden. Let's figure out why the rabbits are so successful, what's making any animal so successful, and change things in the environment to make it less successful. Because, again, in terms of old methods, people tend to still want to go and grab a trap, set some form of a trap and remove that animal. But nature won't allow that void to go unfilled, and so another animal will come to take its place.
That's an excellent point, yeah.
Yeah, it's borne out time and time again. By the time I get to somebody that has a rabbit problem, they've trapped 60 rabbits, and they can't understand why they still have rabbits. So that's a common scenario.
Well, isn't it true that if you remove if you remove a creature that you view to be a pest, that, as you pointed out before, you know, nature won't allow it. Something else will take its place. Like, for example, in upstate New York, the dire situation with the tent caterpillars. I remember how there was one pest problem, so they brought the tent caterpillars in, and then basically you have issues where, you know, entire forests are being chomped down, or chomped on, however you want to put it. They're being destroyed by these caterpillars, and it's all because of one person's decision to introduce this, to introduce them into the environment, and then, you know, it just runs rampant.
Absolutely. New York State, along with many other states, has a long history of introducing non-native species that oftentimes go on to become a problem. Now, sometimes it takes years or decades for those animals to become a problem, but usually that's what occurs. And there's many examples. The mute swan. The mute swan is a non-native swan. It outcompetes native waterfowl. It has an aggressive behavior, but it was imported because swans are really pretty to look at. And so that's just one example. The European starling is probably the most common example of an introduced invasive species. You know, introduced in the 1800s, and now the starling exists all over North America and oftentimes outcompetes native songbirds. So, yeah, the non-native animal and the introduced species, that's a long problem that will be with us for a long, long time.
Now, you happen to be an expert on falcons, correct?
Well, I am a licensed falconer.
And what does that exactly entail, being a licensed falconer?
Falconry is an ancient art of hunting with trained birds of prey. It's the way people got meat before gunpowder. And falconry exists all over the world. It exists in every culture. It's just very little is known about it in the mainstream these days because with the advent of agriculture and gunpowder and stuff in our history, falconry was sort of forgotten. But it exists in every culture, and there's about maybe 250 licensed falconers here in New York State.
So how does that work? You actually go hunting with birds?
The birds actually do the hunting. They do what wild birds do. The only difference is these birds allow us to go with them, and they view us as partners. It is a true partnership with a wild creature. It is one that does not upset the balance of nature, does not upset the bird. It can be engaged in with captive bred raptors or actually raptors that we trap from the wild. We trap them safely and humanely by virtue of special permits from the federal government, and then we release them back into the environment often when we're through hunting with them. So it's a totally green, totally non-invasive way to be involved with wildlife. It's extraordinary. You learn a lot about yourself, and you learn a lot about wildlife while you're doing it. And it's a pretty fascinating thing. It has taught me a lot about not only raptors, all birds of prey, but it's taught me a lot about wildlife in general, because you can learn about wildlife in a way that you can't learn any other way when you pursue it with its natural predator.
What does the bird actually get out of it?
The bird actually gets to eat, which is all a bird of prey wants to get out of it. It wants to fly, engage in its natural behavior, and as a predator, it wants to catch something and eat it, and that's what they get to do exactly that, which is what wild hawks do.
If you're hunting with it, aren't you the one killing the animal?
No, the bird is doing that. We are there to observe, to assist the bird in flushing the game, perhaps, and to keep the birds safe from dangerous quarry. But the birds do everything. The birds may need assistance sometimes with a large, depending on the quarry, but the human is the partner. The human is the lesser of the partnership. We can't fly. We don't have great eyesight. The birds just learn to trust us and to cooperate with us.
Interesting. So how long have you been doing that?
I've been doing that for about 10 years. I went to a wildlife lecture about 10 years ago, and a falconer was there lecturing some wildlife rehabilitators. I'm also a wildlife rehabilitator. He was lecturing wildlife rehabilitators in techniques to keep raptors healthy, and he released the hawk outside for the entire audience and whistled, and the hawk flew back and landed on his fist, and something in me snapped, and 3 years later, I became a falconer.
Wow. So, I'm not a supporter of hunting, but I do have friends that's basically the method that they provide for their families. I mean,
It's a personal choice.
It's a very personal choice, yes. Now, getting back to some of the issues with that, especially in the Northeast here, for example, with bears, what can somebody really do about the fact that there are so many bears that are now in the same space that we're in? And I know of a beekeeper up in New England that all of their hives were destroyed because the bears got to the hives, and that was the end of it. And they had contacted, I guess, somebody from the state, from the EPA, I guess, and, it took quite some time before they could get some assistance, but even still, basically they couldn't really do much of anything.
Yes, the bear situation, probably everywhere in the Northeast, and particularly New York State, is an interesting and a complex one. and one that many of us are still learning about, myself included. It's probably one of the only quote-unquote nuisance animals where there's probably not as much that the average farmer, beekeeper, or homeowner can do to directly modify the bear's behavior without the help of their local game agency. And let me give you an example. The bear is a large, powerful creature, and people are concerned about bears. But the reality of it is that in 150 years of New York State history, there's only been one recorded black bear fatality. And that's important for people to remember. You know, the black bears, again, they're large and they're powerful, but they're not interested in hurting anybody. They're interested in, like all wildlife, exploiting what we provide them unwittingly, whether it's beehives or whether it's garbage or bird seed or things like that. So in terms of, like, say, the beekeeping situation, you know, if an electric fence isn't going to work for the hives, then they have to enlist the help of their local game agency to try and retrain that bear. And wildlife biologists have a number of methods that they use to retrain black bears, oftentimes with bait bombs, you know, exploding baits that scare the bear, oftentimes rubber projectiles, noise devices, things like
that. But doesn't that hurt the animal?
No, no, there's no permanent damage to the animal. What they're looking for is to elicit a fear response. What's interesting about black bear, like many wild creatures, is they're very intelligent, like raccoons. They learn a lesson, they learn it very quickly, and they learn it permanently. In other words, on the downside with black bears is if we feed a black bear one time, he never forgets. If we scare a black bear, and we scare him badly enough, he never forgets. And so
by human beings should be, I was going to say, human beings should be so fortunate to have that capacity. And unfortunately, human beings, I mean, I've seen many people make the same mistake over and over and over. And it's almost, in some situations, it's almost comical. But yet, a bear, it's very interesting that you point out that a bear or a raccoon is so intelligent that they just need to do it once and that's enough. Whereas
that's
human
enough.
Beings, we're, you know, we're gluttons for punishment. We have to do it over and over and over until, you know, we get the memo that, yeah, this isn't a good idea.
Absolutely. It's ironic, isn't it?
Yeah.
Theoretically, we're more intelligent. But, you know, the wildlife, if they don't learn these lessons, they don't survive. So it speaks directly to the way they're designed. You know, they're designed to do a job out there in the environment, and if they don't learn these lessons, they can't do their job. And so in that regard, they're probably more equipped to learn quickly than we are in a lot of ways.
Well, so now with raccoons, it's interesting that you point out raccoons. Most people, including myself, raccoons, I kind of leave them alone, but I don't encourage them, but I do know that I have them. I don't know much about raccoons, but I do know that, yeah, they are really smart creatures. I remember once, this is during the summertime, they landed on my roof, and it was in the middle of the night, and they actually walked right up to the window, and I took the flashlight to scare them off, and they didn't really seem to mind. They came even closer. I came right up to the window to look inside, and I thought to myself, "Wow, that's really audacious."
Yeah, that's behavior indicative of a raccoon that's grown up around people and has profited from people either, you know, by accident or on purpose. We're living in a world where many people are under the assumption that wildlife in urban areas needs to be fed because there is quote unquote no food where they are, and nothing could be further from the truth, particularly with an omnivore like a raccoon. Wildlife in general does not need to be fed. But people, you know, insist on feeding wildlife. This causes more problems. It doesn't fix anything, but it causes or it can cause a host of problems with getting animals really familiar with coming to our homes. Whereas left alone, they're way less likely to come up to the door, look in the windows, spend time out in the open in our backyards. But once they learn that food is available or possibly available, then their behavior can change drastically.
Well, you know, it's interesting. I have a compost bin that's on the side of my yard, on the side of one of my gardens, and interestingly enough, they have never tried to get in there.
Oh, that's sort of surprising. Does it have a really heavy lid?
No, not at all. It's actually one of these, I guess, more fashionable compost units. I actually purchased it because I wanted it. When I was volunteering at the Brooklyn Botanic Garden, they had some of them. So I decided, well, you know, since a lot of people are using them, I wanted to see what they were like myself. So that's why I got one. And I've been really surprised that the squirrels haven't tried to get in there. The raccoons haven't knocked it over. Nothing. And on my property, I have fruit trees, and I also have I grow a lot of turnip greens, kale, collard greens, stuff like that. And some of it, I mean, there's a lot that I don't use, so it just kind of self-sows and it's out there.
Well, there could be a number of things. It sounds like you have alternate food sources for terrestrial mammals in your yard. And also, if you've got a really good, efficient compost pile that with a good acceleration rate, it's possible that there's just limited possible food supply in the pile if it's composting pretty rapidly.
Yeah,
there's just not nothing of interest in there, you know.
I guess I do a really good job of feeding the critters.
Yeah.
We have a caller. Good afternoon. Caller, area code 909. Are you there?
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Hi, good afternoon. Do you have a question for Joel?
Yeah, very interesting what you were talking about black bears. I live in the San Bernardino National Forest in Southern California, which happens to be the most populated national forest in the country. And we have a lot of wildlife, needless to say, bears, raccoons, squirrels, chipmunks, you know, the whole forest. And the black bear seems to be a creature that we all love to watch, but we also are not very knowledgeable and educated on it. And you mentioned about how it has a very good memory. There was a bear that was recently killed because it was considered a nuisance.
Yes, these decisions about black bears pretty much across the country are left up to the local game agencies. Now, sometimes the local municipalities, the police departments may have input into that. Typically, these are young bears that are males that are wandering around looking for territory. That's the way it is in New York State anyway. They get into a populated area, and they start to cause a lot of panic just by the fact that they're in close proximity to people. And if a game agency or a police department decides that, you know, a police department's job is public safety. That's the paramount for them. If they decide based on their knowledge or lack of knowledge about these animals that the animal needs to be removed or needs to be put down because of public safety, then that's liable to happen. Usually game departments, if left to their own devices, will try to educate people and at the same time try to either educate the bear but with a scare device or use chemical capture and transport him. Sometimes it's not really as easy to relocate an animal like a bear as people would think because they're capable of traveling great distances and often
will
come back anyway.
Yeah, and that's what we were told. But I had never heard about the scare tactic. That's quite interesting. So for your recommendation, you would shoot it with a beanbag or something like that to really give it a good pain. And so it would remember,
yes.
Oh, I'm not going there anymore.
Well, yeah, the proper authorities use beanbag rounds and rubber rounds and things like that that cause the bear discomfort but no serious damage at all. And what you're looking for is to give it a real negative experience, and oftentimes that's all it takes to retrain an animal like that.
Yeah, but isn't it going to also irritate the animal where any time that they see a human being, they're going to know that, okay, yeah, I don't want to go near these creatures. They're evil. They want to cause me pain, so, you know, they're my enemy.
Well, actually, yeah, that's what you're looking for. You're looking for these animals not to want anything to do with people. You know, enemy, things like that, that's pretty much, now we're getting into the realm of some more of an anthropomorphic kind of a thing. You want the bear to associate people with an unpleasant experience so they stay out of the garbage can. And so that's really the concept that the agencies are looking for.
But where are these bears supposed to go?
Well, again, now we get into the complex part of the issue. Here in New York State, they've changed the seasons for bear hunting to allow more bears to survive. Now, that's a good thing for the bears, but it also has allowed a larger population of statistically two-year-old male bears to begin to wander. And in New York State, we have three bear populations. And it may be a parallel situation out there where the caller is, but in New York State, we have the Allegheny bears, we have the Adirondack bear population, and the Catskill bears. So here where I live in western New York, we have the Allegheny bears can't go east because of the Catskills. They can't go north because of the Adirondacks, so they migrate north into the lake plains of the Great Lakes. And so we're seeing statistically more two-and-a-half-year-old bears in the summertime. They've been kicked out by mom. They need to find their own territory, and they're wandering around. And it is a seasonal thing. And it's going to continue as long as the bear populations begin to increase or stay at high numbers. So it becomes a delicate balance for wildlife management organizations. We want bears. Bears are like all wildlife. They're useful, and people enjoy them in a number of ways. But when populations increase, animals will look for territory.
I think that's because we're increasing, we're taking up their space. I mean, the amount of farmland in upstate New York that has basically been ripped apart to put up these new developments is, you know, it's horrible. They're basically ripping apart the landscape to put up these really expensive housing developments that really nobody can afford, especially in this economy, and these developments are basically empty. But yet, now that they've removed the natural habitat, where are these creatures supposed to go?
Yes. I mean, there is places in New York State, as there are many places in North America, where it does come down to wholesale loss of habitat. And that what that does is not only remove available habitat for a variety of wildlife, but it compresses the remaining habitat. You know, in those large developments, those types of places can actually support a lot of wildlife, but the habitat is what we call compressed. When the habitat's compressed, we have people and wildlife bumping up against each other a whole lot more often than otherwise would happen. So, yeah, that is an issue.
So, for example, what can the Parks Department do? I mean, it just seems as though the animals, their habitat is being decreased, and for obviously our own existence. And the thing is that the more natural forests and preserves that are being wiped out, the less space that these creatures have to, you know, just exist as they are.
Yeah, I'm not certain there's any easy answer. You know, what's interesting is that up here where I live near Lake Ontario, people have been very concerned about black bears. But yet, if you travel an hour or so south where people see bears all the time, they get rather blasé about the whole thing. It's like, oh, yeah, we have bears. We just bring the bird feeder in. We make sure the garbage is in really good shape and it's stored properly and the bears aren't usually a problem. You know, bears have existed for many, many years in New York State. If you travel to areas that have a lot of bears, people have a lot different attitude than the people that are now seeing bears. So, again, it comes down to our behavior and our perceptions, too.
Joel, you bring up a good point. It's Wayne again here. And this is a great subject, June. Thanks for bringing this to the show.
Sure.
Are you encouraging, then, and looking at just learning to cohabitate with these animals? Because it seems like with squirrels and chipmunks and birds, you know, those are easy to live with. But when the bigger animals come, it seems like there's a big conflict. But I think
bigger animals can hurt.
Joel, mentioned that I think animals are just as scared of us as we could be of them.
It's true. And again, 150 years of history with the black bear in New York State, there's one fatality. And in that one fatality, the people did every possible thing wrong they could have done, which resulted in the death of a young child. Mm-hmm. And it's just like we see bears all the time. And I think, you know, like all wildlife, the black bear isn't going anywhere. It's, you know, we're going to have to learn to live with that. The closer and closer we live to wildlife, we come up against these problems all the time. And we're just going to have to learn how to do that. And now, are there going to be times when a black bear is going to need to be removed? I think so, unfortunately. Unfortunately, where I live, last summer or the summer before, we had to have a young black bear shot. It was a decision made by the police. Was it a good one? I think it was the best decision they could have made based on how new this type of phenomenon is in my part of New York State.
Well, what happened that the bear needed to be shot?
He wandered into a suburb, and everywhere he went, he saw people taking pictures and jumping up and down and great commotion and police cars. And pretty soon the police decided, you know, before somebody gets hurt, I think we're going to shoot the bear.
So they couldn't use a tranquilizer gun and remove him and release him elsewhere?
The problem with it is, although that is, it is logistically, it is biologically possible, the logistics of that are really, really a problem. Chemical capture, I'm certified in chemical capture. I've done a lot of chemical capture with deer and other smaller mammals. And the first thing I can tell you about chemical capture is they only fall over right away on TV. Only when we're watching Mutual of Omaha's Wild Kingdom does the animal fall over with a dart in it. Otherwise, it can take anywhere from 15 to 45 minutes. Now, an animal, if I'm going to put a dart in an animal, any animal, I need to be able to recover that dart and that animal. If I don't know where that animal is, I have no ethical business putting it under anesthesia, which is essentially what chemical capture is. So for bears, for example, the only time where it would be a shoot situation is if the bear was up a tree, because he's likely to stay up the tree until if and when he succumbs to the tranquilizer. If I dart that bear on the ground, A, someone's going to get hurt, B, he's going to run through someone's patio door, or C, he's going to be, you know, two counties away by the time he falls over. So the situations where we can use chemical capture for all species are way more limited than most of us think.
I just think that, I just still have a hard time with that. In this day and age when they can do so many different things, it seems as though that's kind of like the quick and easy solution instead of really trying to do something that, and especially with a young bear. I just think that that's still no excuse.
Yeah, I understand that, and that's...
the expert trappers and everything else that they have, you know, I don't know.
It's unfortunate, June, and I understand completely where you're coming from, but I can tell you with great certainty, chemical capture is neither quick nor easy. And the problem with the bear here that I was mentioning was there were a limited number of municipalities or organizations that had access to chemical capture equipment. It isn't like this equipment exists in every squad car, nor are there policemen trained to use it. It's essentially anesthesia in the field. It seems really easy on TV. There is a lot that goes with chemical capture. And I've had great success with it over the years, and I've had a lot of failures. And that's the dirty little secret of chemical capture that you really don't know, is it's a very inexact science.
Yeah, it just seems such a shame. But in regards to the situation, just with the public taking pictures and whatnot, I mean, if you see a bear that is, in your yard, yeah, I can understand if you want to take a picture of it. But, what were they doing, going up to it, taking pictures and just antagonizing the creature?
Well, what you had was a densely populated suburb, here outside of Buffalo, and the bear was migrating through, and he found himself in the suburb. And you can imagine how news spread that there was a bear over there in such and such development. And everywhere he went, people were, you know, coming out of their houses, taking pictures, yelling, commotion. He wanted out of there, and he was close to being out of there. But before he could get through the suburb and continue on his way, the local law enforcement made a decision. Again, and I wasn't there. I heard about it. We were there as in an advisory role after the fact. But, they made the best decision they thought they could make at the time. And the unfortunate thing is this is probably going to happen again because we have a lot of suburbs in New York State and we have more and more bears.
Now, what about the coyote situation? I mean, coyotes are, you're talking about an animal that is, you hear the stories where coyotes will not only kill small dogs, cats, what have you, but there have been some reports where the coyotes will actually, swipe children or attack children. And is it because of the fact that people continue to try to domesticate these animals? I mean, it's absurd. I've had Laura Lassiter on the show several times. I had Carol Baskin from Big Cat Rescue. And now these ladies are big advocates of, wildlife preservation. And the thing is that when I listen to them talk about how people will get these exotic animals as pets, it's like, what are they thinking? And then to try to domesticate a coyote, that's just plain stupidity. And then I hear stories about people trying to breed their dogs with wolves. That's another sheer stupidity. Maybe human beings have missed out on the one trait that the bears and the raccoons have picked up on, which is, they make a mistake, learn it once, and, that's it. But, no, we have to keep doing this over and over. So, what do you think is the deal with the coyotes?
Well, again, I think the rise in coyote population has to do with, it's habitat-related. They're another really highly adaptive animal. I find it interesting that the rise in deer population and the rise in coyote populations tend to be roughly parallel, and they also parallel the increase in suburban growth in New York State. So in other words, the more people, the more suburbs, the more deer, the more coyotes. Now, there are different reasons that those things are all related, but I just find it very, very interesting. Coyotes eat a lot of things. As a matter of fact, it's easier to list what a coyote won't eat rather than what it will eat. But most of what it eats is vegetation. There are far more items on its menu that are organic in terms of plant material rather than mammal. They're great mousers. They will eat rabbits. They'll hunt deer even when they get an opportunity. But if they weren't omnivores, there's no way they would be as successful in the environment. And I've personally examined stomach contents of coyotes that have been struck by automobiles, and most of what's in there is plant material of some kind or another, except in the dead of winter when they're pretty much limited to hunting other animals. Mm. But, if someone has a small dog, people ask me about dogs and coyotes. If you have a Pomeranian and you put him on a chain or a rope in your backyard and you leave him unsupervised, you're essentially fishing. Because coyotes are really intelligent, and they can really discern that when an animal can't get away. But I don't think the average person, and history will bear me out, that the average person with the average dog that is supervised on a lead has anything to fear from coyotes. But if we leave a small dog unsupervised and tied up or in a kennel that can be scaled, I think we get what we ask for in those kind of situations.
Yeah, it's true. Especially with small dogs and whatnot. But what about the coyotes that travel into the cities? Someplace out in California, I don't remember. I heard it on the news a couple of weeks ago. There was some city in which the coyotes, you could see them on the outskirts, and they were there. They were hunting. And I think there was a situation where a coyote walked up to a group of children that was playing, and then there was one little kid that I think was on a tricycle or something, and it pulled at its arm or something like that, and then the other kids came and, you know, they hit it with a stick or something, and then the thing took off. But, I mean, what about that? I mean, why are they going into the cities when, you know, you see cars, buses, all sorts of different vehicles, and, you know, it's clearly very populated, but yet these animals are going in there?
Clearly, it's they're going in there because it's there's a great amount of food in the city for coyotes. There's improperly stored garbage. There are rodent populations because we are a sloppy, lazy people these days. Restaurants do not call for dumpster pickups when they should. Many people leave their yards with a great degree of clutter that draws insects and rodents. And, you know, those types of factors draw these animals in. You know, out west where we're referring to are some of the largest metro areas in the country in California. Suburbs are way larger than any kind of suburb we have in New York State. The larger the suburb, the larger of environmental factors, the greater number of environmental factors, and obviously, you know, the greater numbers of nuisance animals you're going to draw into those types of areas. So when you're talking about an animal like a coyote, you're talking about, you know, there's a food supply, and they're in there because they can take advantage of that food supply. Whether it's natural or unnatural, they're going to take advantage of a food supply. With regards to contact with children and people, I often wonder if those animals aren't ones that have learned that people need food, you know. So they lose their fear of people when they begin to associate us with food. That coupled with the fact that if you have a population of coyotes that aren't shot at and hunted, which is increasing all the time, we have animals that, you know, a population of animals that can lose their fear of people. But it starts with the environmental factors that we may or may not have control over. Most of the time we have control over a lot, and we just don't realize it.
Now, Mr. Wayne, who's actually in our chat room, made a comment that the coyotes don't usually travel in packs, and then he wrote that they're actually more afraid of mountain lions.
Well, the mountain lion in California has enjoyed a complete unilateral protection in many areas, and so it is no longer hunted and can't even be controlled by lethal means. And so now we have large predators that can easily lose their fear of people. And I think that that's, you know, unfortunately, I think that that sort of lent itself to that type of a problem. You know, I think legislation to protect our natural resources is a really great and necessary thing. But, you know, sometimes we craft legislation and it becomes a big blunt instrument that doesn't address what can happen or what could happen or what should happen with regards to the many ways that we interact with wildlife. You know, it's not practical, and I know that there's a lot of people and probably a lot in your listenership that say everything should just be protected all the time from everybody. And that's not really practical, nor is it really proper. And so, again, the mountain lion enjoys great protection in California, and a couple have decided that people are easy prey, which they are.
Interesting. So, I mean, well, just take a step back. Why is the mountain lion now, I mean, what were the changes that led up to this, I guess, different way of dealing with the mountain lions? How come they had a change of heart and they've decided that, you know, they no longer wish to hunt them?
Well, I think the populations of mountain lions went down. They're sensitive cats, and they don't really historically do well around a lot of people, or they didn't. And they were easily hunted down to, like, very, very low numbers that people were worried they would not become sustainable. But again, another thing about mountain lions is that they need a huge amount. One mountain lion needs a huge amount of territory. And so now we get back to the wholesale loss of habitat. So we take away so much habitat, now that one mountain lion has to go somewhere else or work that much harder to get enough large prey to sustain it. And so there's many, many issues that, you know, pressure put on certain species, loss of habitat. increasing populations of people, things like that. And so I think in many areas of California, the big cats, you know, dropped in numbers. And then you have the, you know, historic complaints with the ranchers and things like that, because, again, these animals, like all the animals, will take advantage of certain situations. And so all of a sudden we decide that we need protection. And I think we need protection. I don't know about protection so much as really good, intelligent wildlife management. I'm a wildlife management guy. I know that because it works and because, you know, it protects our natural resources. But I think sometimes it gets out of hand, and I think we got into a situation in California where the animals' protection now isn't really doing it any good, and it certainly you know, contributed to a problem out there.
Well, what do you recommend that, I mean, how can people get involved?
Well,
because obviously there needs to be a great change, because, I mean, the animals are they're losing their home while we're expanding our territory. So
sure.
What can we really do as a society? I mean, obviously the animals, once we remove one animal, as you pointed out earlier in the show, nature will find something to substitute it with. And time again, you know, we've proven to ourselves that every time we remove one species, whether it's an insect, whether it's an animal, doesn't matter what it is, something else will take its place. So how can we coexist?
Well, that's an excellent point, and it's a really good question, and it addresses largely one of the reasons that I wrote Creature Comforts, Wildlife Stories and Solutions, because I think one of the keys to these types of problems are education. We need to educate ourselves about the wildlife that we're living next door to. You know, there's generations of people that are growing up now in this country, and their only real practical knowledge of wildlife, whether, you know, wildlife in general or the native wildlife in their backyard, is what they learn on the Discovery Channel or misinformation that's just passed around. No one really knows. I mean, it's just amazing to me. The amount of people that I can talk to on the phone during the course of the year in my job that have no idea what it is in their backyard. The phone will ring, there's a beaver in my backyard. No, it's really a woodchuck. There's a hawk in my backyard. You have to come and get it. It's going to carry my kid away. It's going to attack my dog. You know, these are just, you know, there's all kinds of myths and misunderstanding about wildlife.
Even in the supermarket, you go into the supermarket and for the most part, the clerks, the staff, what have you, they don't know the difference between squash and zucchini or lettuce and kale. I mean,
there you go.
You know, it all looks the same, and the same thing is the same thing with nature. And the thing is that I think that is basically because of the fact that people are so removed from nature. When I teach children about composting, for the most part, I mean, I've been seeing this lately, and this is really disturbing. I'll hear from children, you know, I don't really like to get dirty because I don't want my mother upset. Or,
right.
You know, oh, that's going to get me dirty. Or, oh, that's so messy. Or just something like that. And it's like, you're a kid. You're supposed to get dirty. That's how you learn.
Absolutely.
It's not going to make your fingers melt.
Right,
you know,
right.
Touching the earth is a good thing.
Yeah, the urbanization of society. You know, we've got kids that they're not outside as much as they were 30 years ago. They're in front of the TV, the video game, the iPod, the computer, which are all great things. I mean, I'm a big fan of technology. But, you know, going outside and hunting for praying mantises or flipping over boards or bird watching, these are things that that are foreign to many, many people. And we're not living as close to the land in many areas of the country. And I think that fuels these types of problems. And, again, that's one of the reasons that I wrote the book.
Yeah, it's that is such a big problem. So what do you recommend to parents and teachers about incorporating wildlife education into their current curriculum, and also, you know, when they're spending time with their families?
Yeah, excellent question. Where I work at the Erie County SPCA, our Humane Education Department is instituting solid curriculums into the local schools with regards to wildlife. An organized, structured wildlife and conservation curriculum where we can get the kids early and teach them about wildlife and teach them about respect for the environment and what it is that they're living next door to. And again, I talk to a lot of kids and increasing numbers of them have no idea about wildlife. Like you said, they have no idea, they can't tell one vegetable from the other. They think that all meat comes on a styrofoam tray and it was made in a factory. They have no idea what a red-tailed hawk is. These are all connected problems that have to do with people living farther and farther away from creation. Absolutely.
Yeah, that's pretty disturbing. And not to mention the fact that I think you're absolutely right. You see so much with these electronic games and whatnot, and everything is artificial. Everything, whether it's Wii or any of these other games, everything's simulated. Nothing is reality. And I think as our modern world continues, we've just removed ourselves so far from nature that it's no wonder why we're having so many issues. I mean, if we can't handle it with our generation, how do we expect the younger generations to coexist with these different creatures and so on and so forth in a way that, you know, is good for everybody? It just
Absolutely.
Seems as though,
I think the key is education.
Well, I mean, there are a lot of different exhibits at different museums, and then they have different preserves, the parks, so on and so forth. What programs have you worked on in your area?
Well, again, I get invited to speak in a number of different areas. I speak at local nature centers. We have a number of them in upstate New York here. Again, where I work, we have we are in the process of standardizing a wildlife education and conservation curriculum that we can bring into classrooms, and the schools can call us up for presentations and things like that, that introduce kids through the use of interactive games, multimedia, and also live animals. As a falconer, I can also use birds in an educational basis, so I have a number of birds of prey that I use that are trained for education, where kids can and people in general can get a close-up look and look at into the eyes of something and get a get an understanding of it that they can't get from TV or a book. That's key.
Yeah, even if you look at some of these video games, just the nature of them, they're very violent, and they don't make it seem, I mean, it just really is forcing our young people that much further away from the things that they really should be connected to. Now,
I totally agree.
One of the things that your book focuses on is just recognizing different things that animals do that we can incorporate into our own existence. Do you want to talk about that for a little bit?
Well, again, a lot of these problems are very basic in the way that we live our lives, the way we build structures. I really think that colleges that teach degrees in, for example, architecture and engineering should really be focusing on wildlife, because it's amazing. You know, the backyard deck is a really that's a popular architectural structure. Everyone likes to sit on a deck these days. We like our decks to float over the grass about 6 inches above the grass, keeps us up out of the bugs, but also creates a space that, for example, a skunk comes by and he says, well, this is a great place to make a burrow. I think I'll pop underneath this deck here, because the skunk that lives out in the woods would use the roots of a big maple tree, and he'd build a burrow underneath it where nothing could dig him out of. Well, the skunks in the suburbs, and there are popular animals in the suburbs, they don't have big trees anymore because we cut them all down. But guess what? We have a lot of decks and pool cabanas and sheds, and these animals get underneath those structures. They don't live under the structure. but they make a burrow in the ground. They dig a hole, and that structure fortifies the entrance to the burrow. So right away, we build something because it works for us, but we don't realize that it's also working for animals that can make us uncomfortable or become a nuisance by virtue of their presence. But we provide that habitat for them to exploit.
Yeah, that's very true. And so they're basically just doing what they would naturally do. It's just we basically recreated what our perception of nature is in a synthetic fashion. And, of course, they're going to come. Now, it's just like that expression, if you build it, they will come. Yeah, well, in this situation, they're definitely coming. So if we're
absolutely
imitating, a gigantic tree because it suits our own needs for simulating, I guess, the outdoor feeling, so on and so forth, then, you know, that's basically we're causing it. Another question from our audience. The things that we've been discussing, are these also discussed in your book?
Absolutely. I talk about the reasons that wildlife exists in our backyard or on our properties or why it's interested in us, the reasons and what we can do to manipulate their behavior or the environment to change their behavior and get them to leave or at least make a coexistence much more possible. The book is largely built around these types of concepts. Along the way, I put in personal stories of my lifetime with animals because I also wanted the book to be a fun, interesting read. And so if I had a personal story that happened to deal with the species we were talking about, I put that in to underscore something or just to entertain. But largely the book deals with these types of problems. Why is the animal there? What can we do to alter and make the animal less successful and change its behavior? And so that's really the reason for the book. So absolutely, we talk about a lot of things like that in the book.
And how has the book been received by different wildlife organizations?
Usually the response, actually, I've done a number of talks for smaller nature centers and things, and they immediately want to stock the book in their gift stores. So the book locally here and on the Internet has been very, very well received. I wanted to write a book that would be a good reference and an entertaining read. Because my research showed me that a lot of books that existed, the few that did, were either very, very dry and clinical or sort of way the other way and very, very cuddly and touchy-feely. And I didn't really want to go to either of those extremes. My only agenda where it comes to wildlife is the truth. And so I wanted to get at the truth. So the book deals with the truth, wherever that leads. Why is the animal there? Usually there's a reason, a non-invasive method that we can get to get it to leave or to make coexisting with it a whole lot more fun.
And how long exactly did it take you to write this book? That's got to be a long time putting this thing together.
Well, it's weird. It depends on how you look at it. You know, the book is probably 10 years in the making only because it took me that long to start realizing that there were things that I was recommending and things that I was learning and things that I was teaching other people, but you know, at my wife's insistence, I would come home from the field or from the animal shelter or an animal rescue with an interesting or an odd story, and she just thought after a while, you know, you ought to be writing this stuff down because it really helps people. So eventually, I ignored her for a long time because she's apparently smarter than I am. But after a while, I just took her advice and started to write. And I planned on being done in a year and a half, and life got in the way, and it took about 3.5 years to get it all completed.
Wow. So, the book was launched in this past August. Are you doing any book signings, any tours? Are you available for educational purposes at schools?
Oh, absolutely. I could call to speak here in my home state of New York. I have on my website, which is www.creaturecomfortsbook.com. There's an upcoming events button where people can click, and I'm doing a book signing at the USA Bird Store outside of Buffalo, New York. That's in a suburb called Clarence. They're a great huge wild bird supply store, a lot of bird seed and bird feeders and things for the backyard, and they're actually stocking the book. We'll be doing a book signing there on Saturday, November 20th, and there's various radio shows and things like that. People can go to the website and get the whole list of upcoming events we'll be speaking on and off the radio.
Well, thank you. And are you on Facebook? I know you said you're not on Twitter yet.
Oh, yeah.
But
yeah, there's a button on the website where they can click on Facebook. So that's www.creaturecomfortsbook.com. They can click on Facebook and go right to the page for the book. I encourage people to go to the website where the book is also available on the website, but they can also leave me a message on the website. If they've got a wildlife tip, I'd love to hear about it. If they've got a question, I'd love to answer it. I'm planning on answering all my emails as quickly as I can get to them. I don't know how many authors offer that, but I'm going to do that because I think it's important that we all have a lot to learn from each other. So if someone has a question for me or a tip for me, I'd love to hear about it.
All right. Well, and once again, do you want to just state what your website is for our audience?
Absolutely. It's the website for the book is www.creaturecomfortsbook.com, and the book is Creature Comforts, Wildlife Stories and Solutions.
Joel, thank you so much for coming on the show. It has been very, very interesting talking to you and to just learn about some of these problems that are really facing our society as we are trying to coexist with nature. So thank you once again for coming on the show. And folks, thank you so much for tuning in. And this is June Sawyer with the Organic Bee Radio Show. Don't forget, the day before Thanksgiving, we are going to have our Gobble to You Wobble charity segment. And my good friend Dennis Weaver is going to be the co-host. And we have some live entertainment and plus a huge charity auction. So look for the information on our website. We're also going to be having a contest in which you can vote for your favorite charity. So look for that at theorganicbee.com. And once again, folks, don't buy the lie and have a great afternoon. And blue number two will eventually kill you, and that's from a birthday cake. It'll give you more.